It's a great personal pleasure to welcome you to this, but officially I would like to ask Father Robert Robbins, who is the pastor here at Church of the Holy Family and ecumenical officer of the Archdiocese of New York, to welcome us here and to lead us in prayer.
Well, welcome to what we call our jewel on 47th Street. The Holy Family has a very interesting history, which most people are not aware of, which I think certainly fits into the theme of this evening. Believe it or not, this building was built in 1924. And New York was in very different days, where the UN now, of course, was a place where we slaughtered animals. Second Avenue was all the breweries. And this piece of property here was actually one of the breweries. And when the building was torn down, the church, which was dedicated then to the Holy Family, was actually built on the corner foundation of what was the old stadium. And I think it's a very interesting idea in terms of the continuation of history that Holy Family Church, still to this day, if you go into the boiler room, you can see it. You can see the old wall that was the wall for the stadium. And so the whole idea of the Holy Family being built on the stables, foundations, and the whole idea that was used in the reorganization of the church upstairs. If you ever go in, you'll see on what is the west wall, three great ceramics. And they present the Holy Family of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph as the refugees of the world. It's after the angel in Matthew's Gospel has appeared to Joseph and tells him to go into Egypt and take your son into this foreign land because there are those who are after his life. And so that entire wall in the ceramics, but then also in the stained glass windows, which are the windows of hope. And in those blue windows, the word hope, in many of the languages of the world, you'll find. But you'll also find there the refugees of the world in the continuing centuries. Most importantly, on October the 4th in 1965, the first time that a Bishop of Rome, the Pope, ever visited the United Nations, that same Pope, Paul VI, came precisely here. And in coming here, he went into the church upstairs, and he held a meeting for ecumenical and interreligious figures. And this is in 1965. So it's with that kind of a history that I really do welcome you to the Church of the Holy Family. I feel it is completely appropriate that you are here and that this is part of our mission. Father Lochran and I, and of course his congregation, we have been friends for a long time. I, at one point, was in residence down at St. Joseph's in Greenwich Village, and they lived around the corner in our old rectory, which was actually nicer than the new rectory. But we have a long history of friendship, and so I welcome you all, and now I ask us all to join in prayer. Hear the words of Jesus as they are recorded in John's Gospel. He says, Father, I am coming to you. I speak this in the world so that they may share my joy completely. I gave them your word, and the world hated them. But they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. As you sent me into the world, so I send them into the world. I pray not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, so that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, so that they may be one, as we are one. Gospel of the Lord. So we reflect that it is a time to give thanks for the many fruits of prayer for unity. In many places, animosity and misunderstanding had given way to respect and friendship between Christians and Christian communities and others. Christians who have gathered together to pray for unity have often joined together in acts of common witness to the gospel and worked side by side in serving those in great need. It is also a time to repent. For in our divisions, we continue to stand under the judgment of Jesus' prayer for unity and Paul's imperative that we be at peace among ourselves. In the present day, Christians are publicly divided on many issues. We fall short of the lofty calling to be signs and instruments of the unity and the peace that is willed by God. And so we pray. Lord, make us one. One in your words, that a single reverent prayer might rise before you. One in our yearning and pursuit of justice. One in love, serving you by serving the least of our sisters and brothers. One in longing for your holy face. Lord, make us one in you, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Another passion, she has a passion for music and myth.
editing or co-editing two libretti for Philip Glass, most recently The Passion of Ramakrishna with James Barsmore, as well as her keen interest in the work of J.R.R. Tolkien. A good friend and acquaintance of several Friars of the Atonement who are here present, and I would point out Father Timothy MacDonald, who's with us from the Graymoor Magdalene Religious Institute, who actually suggested Kasumina to us, Father Will Terrell as well, who's joined us as well, and Father Elias Mallon, who was a former director of the Graymoor Magdalene Religious Institute. It's good to see you here. Dr. Peterson, as I said, is a good friend or acquaintance to several of them, and she accepted the task of presenting tonight with great interest and gusto. We are pleased that her work tonight will appear in a forthcoming issue of Ecumenical Trends and is being videoed for our use at Graymoor Ecumenical and Interreligious Institute. May I present a fellow traveler from the interreligious movement, a true scholar, and interfaith voice, Kasumina Proselytization.
It's really a great honor for me to give the second Graymoor lecture, and I really am very grateful to be invited. And I'd like to add that it's a special joy, a deep joy, to respond to an invitation from dear friends among the Friars of the Atonement. Now, the topic for this evening was not my choice alone, but we concluded that I would address this topic kind of through a dialogue that we had. And it's because this is the topic of proselytization and conversion. It is a very important interreligious topic and a very painful one. And it's sensitive, even explosive, and it's complicated, and the topic goes off in all directions. And so I have done my best to grapple with the issues, and so in that spirit, let me offer some thoughts that I hope may be clarifying and constructive. Not long after his enlightenment, the Buddha sent out his monastic disciples to preach the Dharma. He said to these 60 monks, "Go now and wander for the welfare and happiness of many, out of compassion for the world, for the benefit, welfare, and happiness of gods and men. Let no two go together. Teach the Dharma that is good in the beginning, good in the middle, and good in the end, with the meaning and the letter. Explain a holy life that is utterly perfect and pure. There are beings with little dust in their eyes who will be lost through not hearing the Dharma." The Buddha's charge to his followers has been compared to the Great Commission at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, in which Jesus says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you." Likewise, at the close of Mark's Gospel, Jesus says, "Go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. The one who believes and is baptized will be saved, and the one who does not believe will be condemned." In the Quran, God requires believers to call or invite others to Islam, saying, "Invite all to the way of your Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. And let there arise out of you a band of people inviting to all that is good, enjoining what is right and forbidding what is wrong." The message of the Quran is to be promulgated to all. This is a warning for mankind. We have sent you as a benevolence to the creatures of the world. For Buddhism, Christianity, and Islam alike, the message to be propagated is universal in intent. Max Müller, the great German Indologist and a founder of the modern study of religion, may have been the first to identify Buddhism, Christianity, and Islam as the missionary religions, in contradistinction to the non-missionary religions, Judaism, Hinduism, and Zoroastrianism. In the 1973 lecture in which he made this identification, he did not mention indigenous traditions, which were, it seems, not to be counted among the religions. Muller stated that the non-missionary religions were declining to their end, leaving three religions which are alive, and between which the decisive battle for the dominion of the world will be fought. It may seem strange to speak of Buddhism as battling with other religions. And much has changed since 1873, but Muller's criteria is still cogent. The missionary religions are those which actively seek converts, a practice called proselytization or proselytism, and the non-missionary religions are those which do not. If the aim of proselytization is to win someone to my religion, we must ask, why should that be my aim in the first place? Why should I try at all to get you to convert? The passages just quoted from Buddhist scripture, the Gospels and the Quran, convey two reasons. First, it is commanded. Followers of the religion are told by its highest authority, the Buddha, Jesus, and God, speaking through the Prophet Muhammad, to spread the teachings of the religion. Second, and let me put this in the simplest way possible, the stated purpose of spreading the teaching is the good of others, or beneficence. This may not be the actual or only purpose in any situation, but speaking theologically, to spread the teaching is an obligation of paramount importance, which no adherent of these three religions, at least, can easily dismiss. So this then raises further and the further and crucial question of the nature of the good to be obtained by embracing a given religion. What is at stake in the attempt to win another to my religion? What is gained if I succeed or lost if I fail? Here the reason to try to convert another and the reason to convert converge in the vision of the highest and most complete good. The good to which the Buddha's Dharma leads is the lessening of suffering and ultimately its complete end with the attainment of enlightenment. When the Buddha says that those being with little dust in their eyes will be needlessly lost if they do not hear the Dharma, he means that they will continue to go through repeated births, subject to the suffering inherent in unillumined existence. Scriptural narratives of the Buddha's life do not indicate other ways than the Buddha's way to the final goal. For Christians, the good news to be proclaimed is salvation from the consequences of sin, a salvation often called eternal life. It hardly needs to be added that just what salvation is and the way to reach it are understood in different ways by Christians. Traditionally, however, it has been construed eschatologically as the saving of souls from damnation, and is still understood this way by many millions. Such a view of salvation has been intrinsic to the Christian missionary enterprise through most of its history. In Islam, the motive of preaching is to bring those who hear to do the good, reject evil, and believe in and worship only the one God. Evildoers, be they hypocrites, idolaters, or atheists, who turn away from God though they have been warned, will receive the just penalty of their deeds in hereafter. Each of these three religions offers a way to what it defines as the highest good, and points out the consequences of not accepting this way. Is this way the only way? If it is, the task of proselytization becomes far more consequential morally. If the followers of other ways are bound to be lost, conversion is then far more urgent. Yet the meaning of lost is not the same for Buddhism, Christianity, and Islam. And it is also possible to answer the question, are followers of other religions lost, by saying, maybe not. Not necessarily, or not completely. One who does not attain enlightenment endures more rebirths. But this is true for Buddhists as well as for non-Buddhists. In both Islam and Christianity, views diverge as to whether damnation is eternal. And in Islam, it could be said that judgment depends more on deeds than on belief. These are vast and contested questions in soteriology, the theology of salvation, and have important implications for relations between religions. We should also consider the so-called non-missionary or non-proselytizing religions, and we may anticipate that the vision of ways to the highest good may be different if the obligation to proselytize is not present. Some religious traditions not only do not proselytize actively, but do not accept converts at all. The practice of certain Native American religions, for example, is not permitted by authorities within the tradition except to those who are born to it. The way to harmony with the Creator, the community of all life, and the earth depends on bioregional context and inheritance. So that I might be advised to instead seek out my own indigenous tradition, which would be somewhat of the old traditions of Britain. The Yoruba religion, on the other hand, does accept converts who are not of African descent. Wande Obumula argues that since all human beings have originally come from Africa, as genetic research now shows us, then the oneness of humanity tells against any wish to exclude non-Africans, even though the religion is African in origin. The Yoruba way is open if the requirements of initiation are met. But no claim is made that this is the only way to be in relationship with God and the gods, God's appointed powers. While Judaism accepts converts, the process involves a test of sincerity as well as knowledge of the life one is entering as a Jew. The particular character of God's covenant with the Jewish people allows for other covenants, such as the Noahide, and Judaism recognizes that there is a place in the world to come for righteous Gentiles. Among the Asian traditions, Buddhism has a formal process of conversion. Sikhism does as well, though it does not seek converts. Jainism does not have a conversion process. While some Hindu authorities have recently devised procedures for formally becoming Hindu, historically this has not been more so definite. It's been more like a process of cultural assimilation. In East Asia, the question of conversion is even more amorphous, as multiple belonging to more than one tradition is routine, and I bracket sectarian and new movements when I say that. Today and in the past, some have engaged in a de facto self-conversion to one or another Asian religion through the adoption of the culture and practices of the tradition they wish to join. Does this happen without any proselytization? The answer is not quite clear in modern times, when many spiritual teachers from Asia have journeyed beyond their home countries to share their spiritual paths. Some years ago, I talked about this with Father Albert Nambia Parambil, who is known to some of you, a native of Kerala who has pioneered the interfaith movement in India. When I said that Swami Vivekananda did not go to America and the Parliament of Religions in order to convert others, Father Albert replied with intensity, yes. But he went to Chicago to say who he was. To say who you are may be proselytization for some. For others, manifesting one's religion, sharing the good, or a form of goodness. Today, many Christians concerned about abuses emphasize the key distinction between proselytization and witness. Surely Swami Vivekananda had little admiration for Christian missionaries, yet he was a superbly compelling witness for the Vedantic universalism, which he spoke of as accepting all religions. For him and other non-missionaries who bear witness, it is acknowledged that the highest good may be attained in some other way than adopting my religion. One can also argue, as S. Mark Hyam does, that different religions may lead to different salvations or kinds of spiritual fulfillment, which are all real but not all the same. Yet in teaching about one's religion to others, the ethics still remains one of beneficence, or doing good. It is when differently conceived goods are at odds that interreligious conflicts arise. With the hope that the religious and ethical nature of proselytization has been clarified somewhat, I turn now to the complex problem of its relation to religious freedom. Religious freedom is a fundamental human right. The founding document of modern human rights as a system of international law is, as you all know, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, adopted by the General Assembly of the United Nations in 1948. Article 18 of the Declaration says, "Everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right includes freedom to change his religion or belief, and freedom either alone or in community with others and in public or private to manifest his religion or belief in teaching, practice, worship, and observance." The Declaration is a proclamation of principles and is not legally binding. Two treaties, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, were later adopted. And Article 18 of the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights has significantly different wording from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights when it says, "Everyone shall have the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right shall include freedom to have or adopt a religion or belief of his choice, rather than to change his religion or belief." And this alteration was made at the request of Muslim majority countries in the legally binding treaty. It can nevertheless be held that freedom to adopt a religion includes, in practice, the freedom to change one's religion. Article 18 goes on, "No one shall be subject to coercion which would impair his freedom to have or to adopt a religion or belief of his choice," and further states that the limitations on religious freedom shall be only those necessary to protect public safety, order, health, or morals, or the fundamental rights and freedoms of others. Here, the moral norm of human dignity, affirmed as universal, trumps any obligation to try to bring others into a particular religion, regardless of its truth as held by its believers. The tensions inherent in the right of religious freedom, as well as its potential conflict with other human rights, are obvious. In ways already discussed, proselytization is essential to certain religions. The right of religious freedom, according to human rights documents, clearly does include the right to proselytize, but always without coercion. The formulation of the right of freedom of religion and belief is intended to protect religious diversity, nonconformity, and dissent from interference and persecution by either the state or non-state actors, whether these are functioning separately or in some sort of alliance in their use of power. Arvind Sharma argues, he's a professor of comparative religions at McGill University, and has written the only scholarly book on Hinduism and human rights. Arvind Sharma argues that the original language of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights on freedom to change one's religion signals a bias in favor of Western religions, which not only proselytize, but view religious belonging in an exclusivist way. That is, they hold that one can have only one religion at a time. And that in having or adopting a religion, one must reject all others. To this, one must respond first that the language was revised early in the evolution of the human rights regime. Also, the legal language of the documents, when applied in practice, does not favor one kind of religion over another, but rather is comprehensive so that all and all kinds of religious beliefs and practices are protected. Some religions place more importance on teaching publicly than others, but these are entitled to protection as much as those that place less importance on them. And to prohibit anyone from manifesting his or her religion in this way is a clear violation of religious freedom. At the same time, since the documents also prohibit coercion, if someone tries to proselytize me, I am free not to hear the teaching. Or if I choose to hear it, not to accept it. At this point, difficulties, however, do arise in practice with regard to what counts as coercion. Colonized and missionized peoples point to the collaboration of religious institutions with the power of governments in massive projects of conquest and conversion. In the past, such triumphalism intended the destruction of whole religious traditions and the cultures with which they were coextensive. Some say it still does. Missionaries may be backed by international bodies and endowed with skillful organization and ample material resources. Their vigor and their commitment to disturbing beliefs in the superiority of their own religion makes proselytizers a perceived or real threat to the age-old spiritual heritage of those they try to persuade. Let us look at the forms coercion or alleged coercion can take. First, there are incontrovertible examples such as threats of death, torture, expulsion, loss of property or employment, withholding medical treatment, the abduction of women with rape and subsequent forced marriage and conversion, and the manipulation of children, including abduction. All are undoubtedly heinous forms of coercion. There is another form of alleged coercion, however, that is the subject of ongoing controversy and discussion. This is what is called inducement or allurement, in which conversion is said to be caused or influenced by the conferral, promise, or perceived prospect of material gain and social advantage. Money, employment, healthcare and education in general, opportunity for what all those things we call a better life. If by changing religious affiliation one stands to gain some advantage in life, does this mean that one's conversion is coerced? We may often think of the embrace of a religion other than one's tradition of origin as the result of a religious quest, a spiritual journey taking many years of reflection and exploration. In considering inducements and allurements, however, we should remember that for countless people, a change of religious affiliation has been exceedingly pragmatic. Some American examples: Japanese immigrants who changed from Pure Land Buddhism to the United Church of Christ. Muslims from Africa who become Catholics. These are all real examples. Jews who become Episcopalians. These moves may seem like part of a calculated strategy of assimilation. A convert may feel that all available religions are good and choose to adopt without the one that makes it more possible to get along in life. A person may also convert in order to marry someone of another faith or to find a spouse. Such pragmatism may be condemned by some, but we cannot necessarily say that a pragmatic conversion is forced. Such a conversion may involve little or no spiritual reflection, but then again, it may actually have a deep spiritual component. The Pew Forum on Religion and Public Life recently reported that 27% of Americans have changed their religious affiliation. Who has the authority to investigate and determine how pure and sincere any given conversion is? It is hard to see anyway that pragmatic, self-interested, and also voluntary conversions can be regulated by law while preserving fundamental freedoms. In spite of this, there are still serious and complex problems in the association of material benefits with conversion. These lie especially in the connection of proselytization to humanitarian and development work by missionaries, especially among the disadvantaged. There can be little question that what is called aid evangelism does exist. A. Rashid Omar comments that while a few Muslim groups have imitated Christian aid evangelism, by and large the Muslim use of relief for dawah purposes, that means to call or invite, pales into insignificance when compared with that of Christian efforts. Now, some Buddhist organizations have very extensive humanitarian and relief programs, and yet so far I've been unable to surface any criticism of them engaging in a kind of Buddhist aid evangelism. Around the time of the 2005 tsunami, numerous allegations were made that evangelical Christian groups saw the disaster as an opportunity to proselytize. And on site, some groups linked aid to religious instruction and church planting. The United States invasion of Iraq was looked upon by some leading American evangelicals as an opportunity to evangelize, and phrase aid evangelism was used openly. There are persistent anecdotes from the field in India of unethical practices in Christian schools and hospitals. But this presentation is not in the nature of a human rights report with all the documentation that would require, and these few examples must here suffice. Unethical practices give rise to cynicism and a failure to grasp that Christianity calls upon its followers to care for the poor, all the poor, and the sick, all the sick. It should be added that many evangelicals will make the point that the mission of caring for the poor and the sick and the mission of bringing the gospel to the unevangelized are continuous. In a commonly used phrase, they are called to care for both the physical and the spiritual needs of those they serve, so that their theology of mission is a kind of seamless garment. While we decry ulterior motives in humanitarian aid, we must remember that not only material aid, but also sharing the gospel are looked upon by many as expressions of love of neighbor. At the Millennium World Peace Summit of 2000, which took place here at the United Nations, these issues were hotly debated. And Cardinal Franz Arinze summed up as follows. All religions teach us to serve the poor. Conversion from one religion to another must always be free, voluntary, and uncoerced. One should neither be forced to convert nor prevented from converting. It is obvious that we cannot prohibit all conversion, and we shall not stop giving aid to the poor because they might like our religion. In India, which we will look at further now as an illustration of these issues, the issue of conversion, as it's called, is very highly politicized. Interreligious tensions have erupted into violence on many occasions, as they are doing at present. Hindu nationalist groups campaign against all forms of missionary activity, declaring that any attempt to get another person to change religion is in itself, in a sense, an act of violence, and that the only purpose of Christian humanitarian work is allurement to convert, and that the effect of conversion is the change of Indian demographics, the destabilization of Indian society, and eventually the destruction of Hindu culture. All of this, their rhetoric says, is by design of the Christians, whether Protestant or Catholic. An exacerbating factor is that there is in modern India a phenomenon of mass conversion by members of oppressed castes, who, if converting from Hinduism to Christianity or Buddhism, refer to themselves as Dalits, the suppressed or crushed. Now, these conversions may involve as many as several thousand people at a time. It happens that the poor, these same oppressed castes, and tribal people, or Adivasis, are the groups with which Christian missionaries are especially concerned. Since it can be estimated that oppressed castes and tribals together may number as many as 300 million, almost a third of the population of India, if the movement of mass conversions out of Hinduism were to grow, it is conceivable that Hindu fears of great demographic and cultural change in India might not be exaggerated. However, the fact is that the percentage of Christians relative to Hindus has declined in recent years and has never been more than 3%. Now, one response to the conversion activity has been the movement of formal reconversion back to Hinduism, or shuddhi, purification, which was begun in the last century by Swami Dayananda Saraswati, founder of the Arya Samaj, a Hindu reform movement, and became a kind of a campaign in the 1930s. Some of the Shankaracharyas, preeminent leaders of Orthodox Hinduism, have stated that since God has placed each of us in a particular religious context which is best for us, none of us should leave the religious tradition into which we are born. And even if one is dissatisfied with one's religious tradition, one does not have the right to change or convert into another religion. In addition, those opposed to conversions have at times tried to restrict it by law. Since independence, three attempts to pass a national anti-conversion law have failed. Meanwhile, eight of India's 28 states have passed anti-conversion laws, though not all are currently in force. And let us now take the law in Gujarat as an example, since it's the most recent. This past spring, the state of Gujarat published the rules and regulations necessary to activate the Freedom of Religion Law, which the legislature had passed in 2003. The law proscribes converting anyone to a different religious group by means of allurement, force, or fraud, which is the standard language for these kinds of laws. And it requires the person conducting the conversion ceremony to apply for permission 1 month beforehand to the local authorities. The law does not, however, detail the criteria for granting or denying permission. It's not explained. By 10 days after the ceremony, full details must be given to the same local authority. A quarterly report of all applications, including reasons for refusals, must be provided to the state government of Gujarat. The penalty for converting someone without legal permission is up to 3 years imprisonment and a fine of about US dollars, $1,250, but if the person is a minor, a woman, or a member of the scheduled caste or tribe, the penalty is more severe. Such laws have been denounced and opposed, in some cases successfully, as violating the right of religious freedom, which is guaranteed by India's constitution. The law's stated purpose of protecting the vulnerable from coercion is not without merit, but the lumping together of unexplained allurement with force and fraud, and focus on already disadvantaged groups, The background rhetoric declaring all charitable work to be deliberate allurement evinces a strain of paternalism towards those claimed to be susceptible and weak and likely to convert away from the dominant religion. Anant Ramacha observes that the convert is very often despised by the religious community he or she leaves for a new one. He says, "We see the act of conversion as one of primal rejection, and because our traditions so deeply define our identities as one of disloyalty to us and our community, our response is accusatory. We characterize the convert as a childlike and an immature individual who is incapable of exercising choice and judgment. We prefer to think that the convert does not cross religious boundaries because of any legitimate dissatisfaction with the inherited tradition or anything of intrinsic worth in the other. It is less challenging for us to think of conversion as the consequence of coercion or material imprisonment, and not as suggesting anything problematic in our tradition or attractive in the other. Many of us who are hostile to the convert are so from positions of power and privilege within our own traditions." Ramachan may have in mind the situation I have just described, ill feeling towards those who convert away from Hinduism. But we may add that the Puritans of New England spoke of the evil eye if one of their number became a Catholic. That in the 1970s, if a young person joined the Unification Church, he or she was said to be brainwashed. And that Catholics have been known to say about the conversion of Latin American Catholics to Pentecostalism that the CIA is behind it. And I heard it myself. It is easy to cry coercion or allurement when a member of one's own community leaves, but it is also a way to deny the agency of these persons, describing them as easily manipulated and incompetent. The paternalistic attitude says, in effect, their religious freedom need not be protected because, in fact, they cannot exercise it. They are incapable of choosing. This patronizes persons who may be poor and less educated, but still know perfectly well how to make a decision about the religion that is best for them. Anti-conversion laws are seen by their critics as an attempt to intimidate religious minorities and control those at the bottom of society. In this light, protectionism is a slippery slope down to the loss of religious freedom along with other civil rights. And yet, interestingly, in India, under these anti-conversion laws, not only has not a single conviction taken place, there hasn't been even one prosecution. The laws until now have been, as far as I can ascertain, just used for harassment, which they are used for. It is instructive to compare this state of affairs in India with a country in the West where proselytization is prohibited by law on the national level. The Constitution of Greece, while it states that freedom of conscience is absolute and all have freedom of worship, forbids proselytization. In a well-known case which reached the European Court of Human Rights in 1993, a Jehovah's Witness, Minos Kokinakis, was prosecuted for having visited a woman in her home. The law under which he was prosecuted said that by proselytism is meant any direct or indirect attempt to intrude on the religious beliefs of a person of a different religious persuasion, with the aim of undermining these beliefs either by any kind of inducement, by the promise of inducement, moral support, or material assistance, or by fraudulent means, or by taking advantage of his inexperience, trust, need, low intellect, or naivete. The European court overturned the conviction of Mr. Kokinakis on the grounds that his right of religious freedom included his right to proselytize, as defined in the European Convention on Human of rites, of which Greece was a part. The woman in question, a Mrs. Kyriaki, was the wife of the cantor in her local Orthodox church. A dissenting opinion of the European court painted Mr. Kokinakis as a wily, campaign-hardened, smooth-talking militant who swooped upon a naive woman in order to beguile her simple soul. This was after it had already been observed by a dissenting appeals judge in Greece that no evidence showed that Kyriakaki was particularly inexperienced in Orthodox Christian belief or was a particularly low intellect or naive. This brings us to the question of coercion through psychological pressure, which for some includes theological argument, or even the expressions of religious beliefs that differ from that of the potential convert, the person being proselytized. Why? Because these expressions of a different belief may disturb that person's prior belief, as indeed they are intended to do. Such communications could include those that seek to arouse anxiety about what will happen after death, or that demonize another religion, and they could be deemed pressuring or coercive, even if such views are sincerely held by those who express them. When I ride the subway in New York and someone is preaching, perhaps with the threat of hellfire, and I cannot leave the train because the train is in motion, is it coercion? This happens quite often, but I have never seen such a preacher shouted down or ejected from the train. And in a public setting, in an open society, I am supposed to just try to ignore the expression of views with which I disagree, even if they are troubling or offensive. And is it coercion if Jehovah's Witnesses come right up to my door and knock, as they do regularly? They have won the right to do so in the United States through a series of Supreme Court cases which find that canvassing door to door is a customary and accepted form of sharing one's views in our society. Say, if you can't afford a very polished television advertisement, then just knock on someone's door. So on some American university campuses, regulations say that one cannot discuss religious matters with a student unless given permission to do so, but one may make the initial approach. In those cases in which a person is protected from undue pressure by the proselytizer, the relevant rules do not forbid teaching about religion specifically. Rather, they protect my privacy, and I am kept safe from harassment whether the approach to me is about religion or is about something else. At the same time, the freedom of religion and freedom of expression of the person approaching me are also protected. So now, where does this leave us? It is my hope to have shown that all this brings us to an impasse. That is my hope. An impasse with regard to the question of regulation of proselytization by law. And there does not seem to be a way to restrict it legally without dangerous risks to religious freedom. I am actually sympathetic to some motives for restricting proselytization, but it is very hard to see how to formulate in legal terms what has been called the right to be let alone. Some exceptional arguments might be made in the case of a small, isolated, and culturally homogeneous territory, such as a Native American reservation, or the country of Bhutan, or in another exception, in cases of large-scale infusions of money and personnel from outside the locality. But even then, protectionist policies must be scrutinized. In a religiously diverse setting, legal restriction seems highly problematic if it is any more extensive than the general prohibition of coercion already found in human rights documents. In conclusion, I propose instead some kinds of constructive action as we engage the problems arising from proselytization. The first is the robust claiming of our human rights. It is never enough for human rights to be inscribed in documents. Citizens must be vigilant, well-informed, and dynamic in ensuring that they are able to exercise their rights. And they must do what is possible to change laws if the laws do not adequately protect religious freedom. Second, we must build commitment to our own religious traditions. Members of religious communities who worry that their heritage will be damaged or lost, or just that they will lose members, must attend to religious education, including precautionary teaching, which is what to do if someone approaches to convert you. They must foster regular observance and be self-critical about any factors that promote voluntary departure, such as social injustice, sterile worship, shallow formation, and merely nominal belonging. Third, I propose that we support the development and adherence to voluntary codes of ethical conversion, especially by religious bodies. Have in mind the recommendations of the interreligious consultation on conversion, assessing the reality, held in Lariano, Italy in May of 2006, and organized by the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue and the Office on Interreligious Relations and Dialogue of the World Council of Churches. And Hans Uko is here with us tonight, and he was a leader in that meeting and document it issued, and I just want him to be acknowledged for this very important work. I'd also like to mention the interreligious code of conduct drafted by Seshagiri Rao, and who's the chief editor of the Encyclopedia Hinduism and Indic Religions, and proposed it in the 2004 Parliament of the World's Religions in Barcelona. In the absence of any simple legal remedy for wrong kinds of proselytization, such voluntary codes can play a very important role, especially if they are widely disseminated and officially adopted. Fourth, in such codes and elsewhere, the distinction between proselytization and witness, to use Christian language, must be promoted, spelled out, and practiced. Fifth, and finally, it would seem to be helpful if actual conversion to, in any religious context, would always be a somewhat exacting process, as it is in Judaism, to ensure its voluntary nature. There is a rabbinical saying that one should bring the convert in with one hand while pushing him or her away with the other. This test of sincerity and commitment is admirable, but it cannot be implemented without equal sincerity by clergy or other religionists who conduct the conversion. In closing, let me reflect on whether controversy over proselytization may fade even without these constructive measures. Throughout this presentation, I have referred to religions as if they are discrete entities with clear boundaries between them. And speaking as if I look upon religious belonging as exclusive, as something it should be. This is not a true picture of religious life as really lived by much of humanity. Arvind Sharma stresses that in Asia, it is well understood that one may belong to more than one religion at a time, and that proselytizing aimed at changing a religion and exclusive adherence to a new religion is a Western concept. In Asian cultures, and indeed in some others, and this is like, there should be a lot more exploration of this, proselytization aimed at religious exclusivism is either meaningless or a drastic religio-cultural imposition. But now it is not only in Asia that we find double belonging, multiple participation, and practicing across boundaries. This is a well-recognized trend and can be a kind of pragmatic pluralism or an integral spirituality. Last but hardly least, soteriologies are shifting. Today, 70% of Americans and even 7% of evangelicals say that one can be saved in a religion other than one's own. Belief in damnation is also under challenge. These heartening changes are a result of positive responses to the encounter of religions now taking place throughout the world, as we try to find ways to live together, rooted in respect for human dignity, for one another's spiritual traditions, and in love of our neighbors.